All right, welcome back, my lovers of learning. We're here at Night Nurse, and we're going to have a good little bit of fun talking about burns and breaking them down, making them a little simpler for you. So burns are massive inflammation. And so any tissue damage from a burn that is caused by either thermal heat or chemical burns or even electrical burns can cause the manifestations of burns. And the effects of burns are massive inflammation. So we recall that inflammation causes increased capillary permeability and vasodilation, and fluid leaves the vascular pipes, it leaves the vascular compartment, and it shifts into the interstitial fluid. And this causes a couple of things. First of all, we lose fluid from our vascular compartment. So this can cause hypovolemia and hypovolemic shock, a loss of blood pressure because of a lack of volume. It also causes edema in the tissue because all of the fluid is shifting into the interstitial fluid, and this edema can cause things other than just poofy feet. It can actually cut off airways and cause respiratory distress. And then burns are very painful. Okay. Later down the road, we also have to worry about infection because burns have taken away our first barrier of defense, our skin layer. And then we have to keep in mind these patients are going to have very high metabolic needs as the inflammation subsides and the skin and the tissue begins to repair. So they will need tons of protein. So let's classify some burns. It's not as complicated as people make it out to be, okay? So the first classification of burn, most minor, we're going to start with the mildest burn to the more severe. So a superficial thickness burn, and this is called a first degree burn. It's superficial because it only affects the epidermis skin. The epi means on top of. So the epidermis layer is the very top layer of skin. A superficial first degree burn only stays in the epidermis, so it does not penetrate past the dead tissues of epidermis, so there are no blisters, and it typically resolves quickly. An example of this is a sunburn, where you see this person obviously wore new sandals and is very burned, but there are no blisters. This is a first-degree superficial thickness burn. The next degree of burn is a partial thickness, second degree burn. It's partial because it's gone completely through the epidermis layer and penetrated part of the dermis layer. Now, the dermis layer is our living tissue. So when you kill the living tissue from damage, then this is going to lead to fluid loss of the dying cells, so we get blistering. So partial thickness second degree burns are known for blistering of the epidermis. It blanches with pressure, which is where when you push down on the red area, the erythematous area, you push down on it and let off, you leave a light fingerprint, and then the color comes back in. That's blanching. It heals, but they may have scars, and studies indicate that partial thickness burns, especially significant partial thickness burns, can lead to an increase in skin cancer risk in the future. So an example is for this patient here. It looks like probably a water burn, boiling water or something like that, has caused a partial thickness second degree burn with erythema and blistering. The final classification we're going to talk about is a full thickness burn or a third degree burn. It's called full thickness because the damage penetrates completely through the epidermis and completely through the dermis layer, and it extends into connective tissue, the nerves, and the vasculature. It does not blanch with pressure because this burn has destroyed much of the vasculature, so there is no blood flow to the area. And it often results in permanent disability. You can see this patient probably had their pants catch on fire. And so you have not only third-degree burns, but you have circumferential burns, which can actually cause a tourniquet effect that we'll talk about. Now, in this patient, some nerves are burned, so obviously there's going to be less central pain in a third-degree burn because you've burned up all the nerves. But third-degree burns are still very, very painful. So why is that? It's because you have second-degree partial thickness burns surrounding the third-degree burn. So don't think that the third-degree burn patient won't be in pain. They will have pain. Now, burn determination can be calculated based on the body surface area that is affected and the Parkland formula. Now, we use the Parkland formula and the rule of nines because we're trying to determine this quickly in a trauma setting. So it's not like you can measure and get out your calculus equations and your abacus and try to determine the total body surface area that is affected with the burn. You need a quick way of determining that. So the Parkland formula and the rule of nine graphs will allow you to do that in the Loon-Browder chart. So you can see here, you can quickly look at a patient and get a rough estimate of the body surface area percentage that is affected by the burn. Now, what you do with that in the Parkland formula is then you calculate 2 to 4 milliliters times the patient's weight in kilograms times the total body surface area that is affected. And then that gives you a calculation of how much fluid they need in the first 24 hours. Fluid is key because a burn is inflammation and fluid is going to shift away from the vascular compartment. So in the first 8 hours, you need to deliver half of the total volume of fluid by the Parkland formula. And then in the remaining 16 hours, you give the other half. So you can see we're really front loading the first 8 hours. Now, this is very aggressive fluid management to avoid the interstitial fluid shift away from the vascular compartment, causing vascular hypovolemia. These patients will get into a lot of trouble in the first day or two if you don't provide them with lots of fluids. So an example of that is you take a 100 kilogram man, which is 220 pound man, so a little over 200 pounds, and they have a 50% affected burn, a total 50% body surface area burn. If you calculate that, they need 20 liters of fluid in the first 24 hours, and they need 10 liters of fluid in the first 8 hours. So that means you have to run fluid at 1,200 cc's an hour for the first 8 hours, which is pretty much bolus as fast as you can run it in. So in the first 8 hours, you are giving that many bags of fluid in this patient. Now, a normal patient, you would throw them into overload and you would probably kill them from pulmonary edema. But you can see that the effect of burns are so massive, you need 10 liters of fluid the first 8 hours and then 10 liters of fluid the remaining 16 hours. The point of this is not so that you can calculate the Parkland formula and fluid resuscitation, although you will use this if you work in the emergency room. The point for pathophysiology introduction is to show you a take-home. Massive inflammation requires massive fluid replacement, or the patient will become hypovolemic. There are some special considerations with burns. So we've already talked about fluid replacement being key with all significant burns because the fluid is going to leave the vascular compartment, the pipes, which is where our blood pressure is made and maintained. So if we lose that fluid, it's just like they're dehydrated, even though the fluid is not leaving them. It's still in their body, but it's in the interstitial fluid. So they are in a severe form of dehydration. So they need fluid replacement. Electrical burns are special because we have to consider cardiac damage. We have to consider that the electrical burn went through the electrical wiring and maybe damaged heart conduction, especially the SA node, which is the internal pacemaker. Circumferential burns can cause a tourniquet effect and cut off blood flow. So like in the example we saw there with the patient who probably their pants caught on fire, and it burned all the way around their legs. You can just imagine that they have as the swelling of the burn and the eschar or thickening up of the tissue occurs, that can act like a tourniquet to their feet. And if you look back on that picture, you can actually see that their feet are already getting puffy, and that's because they're starting to get blood flow cut off. So if ischemia develops distally to the feet because of a circumferential burn, they may need to perform an escharotomy where they take a scalpel and they actually cut the tourniquet. They cut the thick burned tissue, and that relieves the tourniquet. Also, we have to worry about infection. So the risk of infection is real because this patient has lost their first barrier defense, their skin. And we have to worry about nutrition. The patient's going to be healing in a very hyper-metabolic state, so they're going to need tons of protein, they're going to need carbohydrates, and again, they will need lots of fluid. Okay, so that's a quick summary of burns. I hope you found that enjoyable and helpful. If you found it helpful or enjoyed it, then always you can always look at the Night Nurse Learning Channel and look for more videos, or you can visit nightnurse.com. I'm constantly building and trying to add new content for you. So I appreciate you, and we'll see you next time.